this is me. And that's all I'm going to say about me. You know, I hate it when people put a slide saying this and that, I won the X Factor, whatever. I hate it. So, what I want to do is to keep you amused, to keep you entertained, to give you some advice for a while, and that's, I think that's all you need to know. So first thing, do you want to be a writer? Not to write? Who wants to be a writer? Okay, I'm going to give you a very useful tool for writing. This is not any pencil, it's an IKEA pencil. It's made by Swedish craftsmen, painfully. It so happens that many people want to be a writer. In fact, you probably write already. So there is literature everywhere. You can find literature in Twitter, you can find literature in blogs, also in reviews, in TripAdvisor reviews, for instance. Anywhere, all over the place, people write all the time. Only they don't write in long form, they don't write novels, they don't write big non-fiction books, whatever. I want to concentrate mainly on the artistic part, I mean on the part where you actually write a novel. And I'm going to talk about that. But why do you write? Why do people write? Sure, people write because they want to be loved. Right? Bryce Echenique is a Peruvian writer. Actually, this guy doesn't be loved too much. So he copied newspaper articles. But you don't have to do that. You don't have to copy your way to fame and fortune and everything. You have to use only three things. I'll come to that later. One thing is writing, other thing is publishing, other different thing is finishing. Start doing something from the very beginning, coming into the end, doing something that's more or less good enough, okay? Something that works. It's a different kettle of fish, but you have to do it, right? Actually write, I know many people who write, many people who start writing, many people who say, I have a novel in my head. People say that people write not because they want it, but because they need it. They have a novel in their head, and they want to see that novel, and to see that novel, to see those characters, they have to make it. Josh Whedon says this, write it, shoot it, publish it, crochet it, saute it, whatever, make. So you have to make, and Pearl is going to help you do that. Josh Whedon made lots of things, good things, Star Trek, and some other things. So what do you need to start making, right? You need something like this, a cinta, which is a drink that's followed by writers all over the world. That's a single thing you need to be a writer. This is the most important thing you need to be a writer. Let me see if you find it. All these personal writers, what do they have in common?
Wild hair.
What?
Wild hair.
Correct. Wild hair. You got another? But this time I'm not going to give you a ball pen. I'm going to give you the best from Cancun. It's a notebook I prepared from a hotel in Cancun. So here you have it.
Wow.
And then you have both things you need to be aware of. You have the notebook and you have the pencil. And that's it. So exactly, you need great hair, or wild hair, or fabulous hair. Actually, do you know the first one I show here? Maybe I'll show it back. Who's this guy?
James Herbo.
Charles Stross.
Ah.
So he's a pearl-monger, he's a Sipan author, and he's also a writer, very good writer. So, I'll come to him later on. Anyways, not everybody can have great hair, right? I can't, I have a soul patch, I grew it only for this talk. But if you don't have great hair, what do you need to be a writer? You need laziness, impatience, and of course, hubris. Hubris is something that every writer has. He wants to create a work, he wants to do something that's special, he wants to populate that world with little characters that do whatever you want sometimes. So Pearl is then an excellent tool for being a writer. First thing, you want to write something and you want to do it now. So I'm going to talk about my latest book, right? Because the scariest moment is always just before you start. You know, people are afraid of the blank page. when they see a blank page, they put it here and say, ah, blank page. So you have to be very patient to start. You need something to make you start, and then, I mean, everything goes down, downhill from there. So I'm going to talk about it in my latest book, right? Every writer, when he talks about anything, he always talks about his books. So I'm going to talk about my book. It's a very interesting book. This is what people say about my book. It reflects the chaos of modern life. You never know what's going to come next. The authors go full circle with this. This is my book. I wrote it with a few lines of code. It's this book, Book of Pete. It's Pete. It's published in Amazon. You can buy it in Amazon. Nobody has ever done it, and I don't expect anybody to do it, but it's there. It's basically a book with the digits of Pete. So it says, here comes a 3, then a 1, then a 4, then 2, then 3 threes, then another 4. And I wrote it like this. That's using Perl. Now this is the first piece of code you're going to do. It's going to be interesting because it shows you how Perl can be used for anything at all, and also how some patterns in Perl, like regular expression, are very useful to do a huge variety of things. Basically, what it does is it takes P, a file with the 9,999 first digits of P, picks them up, and then what it says, it finds patterns like 2 threes, 3 twos, whatever, and it substitutes those patterns by the name of the digits plus some random phrase, like here comes 4 threes, and then, wait for it, 3 fours, and then whatever, just a comma, whatever. It's random. Every time you run this script, you get a new book, right? I could publish them all. Nobody would buy them, and I know positively that nobody ever is going to read them. Maybe somebody will, but nobody ever is going to read them. But here you have it. It's a little bit longer, actually. It's published in GitHub, everything. It's very interesting because it was inspired by some other, I mean, the same thing that was on before in Spanish. I was also a Perl script. I only added it a little bit and made it a little bit shorter, so I carried down to basically those lines. It was published before, and this guy published 10,000 digits of P in Spanish, and he sold 2 books, which is much more than many poets can say. So here's a book. You can buy it, of course, it's free. And there's a funny thing about this. You know, I had some interesting interchange with Amazon when I wanted to publish it. First thing is, I said there was an author, right? So I just wanted to be the editor, and then they told me, you don't have an author in your book. I said, no, there's no author in P. Who made P? Nobody made P. So, okay, I'll go with that, and I put my name and the name of my colleague, Angel, as an author. And then it came back. I wanted to put it into the public domain because, I mean, it's P. Who can it not be in the public domain? And then they told me, okay, if you want it to be in the public domain, you must tell me the name of the authors and when they died. So, the author of P, for some religions, is to be a god. For some others, the god of mathematics. For some other religion, is just the devil. And then, did it die? I mean, okay, it's a god, so it never dies, or it's not alive, so what can I say? I mean, they were very smart with it, and they accepted it, and they eventually allowed me to publish it, and actually you can see it in all the Amazon books. And the code is right here. I mean, it's very easy, it's just a file with lots of numbers, but I mean, you can do any variation of this. You can do the book of E, you can do the book, if you are physically oriented, the Planck's constant. You can do anything. I mean, you have a whole series. But this is not a book. I mean, it doesn't have a plot, doesn't have anything like that. There's another way of writing a book. There's another way of impatiently, of making your laziness work for you and write a book for you. Instead of writing a book, generate it. There is a whole month, the month of November, it's called the National Novel Generating Month. So people start generating novels all the time. How do they do it? I can see this. It's
So I take out the Cthulhu. Okay, now it's better.
What is this? Very interesting. This was published by Charles Strauss, the guy I told before. He's a Perl, he knows Perl, he writes in Perl. And he published it last December. The basic idea is this. You have a huge corpus of things that are in the public domain. And what you do is you measure the number of times a word appears behind one word or two words or three words. Okay, that's called a Markov chain, right? Algorithm Markov chain, which is an excellent module which is in C1, does that for you. So instead of working with a single novel or with a single corpus of writing, like let's say Cthulhu or the works by Lovecraft, he mixed two different things: the Bible and all the works by Lovecraft, and he came with Love Bible. It's not the Bible of Love; it's the Bible of Lovecraft. And it was all like this. It's very easy. You first analyze the stuff, okay? So what you do is you have the two files, two text files with lots of things, and what you do is you generate some random words and let the algorithm chain some other words. So you pick the first word, then the algorithm picks the one word that's most frequent or maybe not so frequent after that, and then so on and so forth, and you create a whole chain, okay? And you write a book, right? It's a long Bible, a whole book. It's kind of, it's been done, many different ways. It's just a matter of choosing two funny things or two completely different things to mix. It was created initially with Ucom programming, and it was mixed with a Cthulhu mice, and then it was done with this, with the Bible, but you can do it pretty much with anything. But you can also do this, read the classics, and then rewrite them. This is taken from a book called Android Karenina. This is the Karenina, this android. It was a Russian woman who was in love with a young android. Or maybe android of the car. I haven't read it, so I mean, there's android somewhere. But there's a whole bunch of books. For instance, Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies. And somewhere like that. It's nice to see that because when you have a word that's in the public domain, like Anna Karenina, because it was written the last century, or you have Pride and Prejudice, all those things are in the public domain. But I'll come to that later, because there's an interesting lesson there. You can do anything you want with them. So you can mix and match them, you can republish, you can do a theater, or you can rewrite them. So read the classics and rewrite them, of course, using Perl. Okay? And you will say, rewriting the classics, that's something that's not done. That's not good. It's not good after him. What do you think about this? You think it's related to some classic? It's Hamlet. Star Wars is Hamlet. It's based on the Shakespeare story. I mean, not the story about to be or not to be, or it could be there, but it so happens that in Hamlet, there's one guy that kills his brother, that father killed Obi-Wan Kenobi, and then they weren't brothers, but they were Jedi brothers. So, I mean, it's not exactly the same, you're writing it, so it's not exactly the same. And then, as a ghost comes to his son and tells him, Obi-Wan Kenobi came to Luke Skywalker and told him that Darth Vader had killed him, and then Luke Skywalker kills Anakin Skywalker. That's Hamlet. So it's been done all the time. And Hamlet has been done endless times. Many classics you see them made into a movie, but sometimes are The Lion King, for instance. The Lion King is also the story of Hamlet. So it's done all the time. Only we can do it better with Perl. Because, of course, there's a very thin line between Pierre Menard, author of Le Quixote. I don't know if you know this story. This is a story, a short story, one of the first stories that was published by Borges. And it's about a guy who wrote the Quixote. Pierre Menard picked up the Quixote and wrote, word by word, the Quixote. And then people started to review the book and say, it's an excellent revision of the classic. It's not a revision, it was exactly the same thing, word by word, right? By the way, there's another story related to that, because somebody wrote the works of Borges, and he was sued. He had to unpublish them, but whatever. And there's another story about the author of the first Chinese translation. What he did was, there was some guy who knew English, and started to read the English translation of the Quixote to another guy who didn't know English. And then this other guy started to write down whatever he interpreted from the English translation. Okay? So, one guy reading to another guy in Chinese, from the English translation. And this other guy in Chinese putting it into literature Chinese, which is apparently different from spoken Chinese. He came up with something that was completely different from Quixote. But a funny thing anyway. So there's a thin line you have to walk, but I walk that line. So what can you do? I actually did this during this Christmas. It was my next to last book. I wrote Zalacaín the Space Adventurer. It was based on a classic Spanish book called Zalacaín el Aventurero. So I put it into the next century and a helmet and some shiny stuff or a thing. So what can you do? First, you obtain a plain text from Gutenberg.org. Then you extract geographical and character names, because it's important. I mean, the only thing you have to change is the names. You can call a space adventurer Pepe or Juan or Joe or whatever, but you can call him, Joe, but not Juan. Then you measure word frequencies, because word frequencies give you an idea of what the story is about. If it's talking constantly about horses, or it's talking about cars, whatever, you have to target those words for changing the story completely, right? So word frequency, besides, so happens that in every literary word, there's a power law in the apparition of words on word frequency. It's called the Sieff law, and it's also a power law in how many times the characters show up, right? Then when you do this, you generate the regular expression for mapping frequent names and generating new ones. And you have to do that. Why? Because sometimes in a single novel, you can have 100, even thousands of different names, geographical names, names of streets, whatever. So you have to do that. But you always have to target the most frequent ones, because those are the ones that are going to be seen. I mean, if Madrid shows up in a space adventure book, doesn't matter too much. But if it shows up once, but if it shows up over and over again, you will be completely out of character and it will throw you off. And then what you do is you replace most frequent words or words group. You do it like this, right? The first thing you have to do is you sort all the word frequencies, right? And then you read the original file, which, you get it from Gutenberg.org. And then what you do is you first work it's basically a substitution. And what you do is you do a lower case, because sometimes the words appear at the beginning of a phrase or appear somewhere. So you do a lower case first, you do a comparison, and then what you do is you substitute it. And then eventually, this will be for names, but for the words will be more or less the same. You capitalize it again, and you put it back. The code is here, right? It's everything open source, of course. And there are several funny stories also related to this. You know, in Spain, April Fool's is December 28th. So I wanted to do this as December 28th. I wanted to say I'm writing a new book and I'm publishing a new book. I actually did it in the end, but it wasn't so good for several reasons. First one is, don't mess with copyright law. What happens with public domain? Public domain is not the same everywhere, right? So public domain exists in its form, basically in the USA, but it doesn't exist mainly in the continental law. So you can say something in the public domain. It so happens that this story, which was written at the beginning of the last century, was publicly available in Spanish, but it's not free. It's not in the public domain. So you can't reproduce it. So eventually what happened? It was published only in Amazon.com, Amazon.co.uk, and some other places that are not in Spanish. Right. You can't do that in Spanish. That's the lesson I learned. But the second thing, of course, that doesn't mean that I'm not going to do it again. I just published it for that day and I pulled it off the next day, so I took it off. I didn't care about that. That doesn't mean that I'm not going to really write the book, but really rewriting it as I did with Android Karenina, like picking up the book, picking up that as a first step, and then doing a bit of revision and things like that, right? But that's a second lesson, that's an interesting lesson. That's something that I had learned before. But you should open source your model. What does it mean? It doesn't mean that you should write a free novel. Some people do, and they do perfectly. Charles Strauss writes Creative Commons novels for a doctoral. That's correct. But they don't open source it. What do I mean by open source? Release early, release often. That means that as soon as you write the first line, it should be in the open. It should be out there for everybody to see, right? It should be also written in a way that's really a source, like Markdown. Do you know Markdown? Markdown is a very simple markup language. You can write very simply to do italics and things like that. You can't do complicated things, but very simple things, you can do it very easily. And it's basically text. So could be LaTeX, but LaTeX is a little bit more complicated. Markdown, anybody can understand Markdown. I mean, a header is something you write, and then equal signs below it. A second level header is some words, and then dashes below it, and so forth. Very easy. So open source your novel, do it from the very beginning, and do it now. That's what I did. Actually, I did it for a novel I wrote last summer, and I am doing it now for a novel I'm writing now, which you can watch. The novel I wrote last summer, and this is the one I'm going to talk about more or less from now on, was in English, so you can basically read it. The one I'm writing now is in Spanish, so you can Google Translate it and have a lot of fun. So, GitHub. Great tool for writers. Do you know GitHub? Everybody knows GitHub? It's a great place to be. I mean, anybody in the open source community uses it. Nobody who writes, or maybe two or three people, use it in the let's say, humanities. Not only literature, but anything else. Law or whatever. I think that GitHub is a great tool for writers. In fact, I wrote an article, I published it in Medium. You can check it out. There, and I really think it's very, very good to write in GitHub for many reasons. First reason, backup. You can do a Lawrence of Arabia because every time you write, you push and it's there in repository. And when I say GitHub, I say GitHub and use it in the open, not with closed repo, with an open repo all the time. But then, so happens that it's very easy to use Perl with GitHub to help you publish things. All the time. For instance, this thing. Git hooks. Do you know what Git hooks are? It's something that happens as soon as you do something. You commit, and then something happens, right? It's like a trigger that's triggered whenever you do an action. This is actually a post-commit hook. It's a post-commit hook for something that's interesting, which is continuous publishing. So GitHub also has some excellent tool, which is called GitHub Pages. But GitHub Pages are basically a different branch of your master project, and they are not updated automatically. So if you want to publish immediately in GitHub Pages, whatever you do, when you do a commit, you have to do something like this, right? A GitHub hook. It's something, it's very easy to use. You just put it into a directory that's called .git/hooks. You put it in Perl, you do a symbolic link. Two or three steps, it's no big deal. This is published in a GIST, and it's also in the project, in the novel project. You can do it very easily. What does it do? Basically, what it does is it looks at the commit and say, what have you changed? And then picks that file from the master branch, put it into the GH Pages branch, add something on top, some formatting instructions, because it's using something called JKit, never mind. It does some stuff on it, right? And then do another commit and put it on the tree, on the GitHub tree. So as soon as you do some patch, you have it published on GitHub Pages, right? As soon as you write something. And what I'm using here is something that's a Git module that comes with Git. There's a git.pm module that's not in Cpanel, but it comes with Git. Only you have to look it up, you have to look for it. And it's not automatic to use it, it's not as easy as Cpanel Git, or it wasn't last summer, maybe it is now. But the thing is that, if you do some magic, it's just a matter of picking git.pm from the git distribution directories and putting it into the CIPAM directories. You can use it and you can do it, right? So it's, it's not a big deal. It's something you can do, it's very easy to do, and it really helps you, because as soon as you do something, as soon as you write something, it's published. Remember, it's an open source node. It's open source, the whole project is open source, the text is Creative Commons, so it's open source, it's there. As soon as I write something, it's there. Here's the novel. I finished it, I published it, don't ask if I sold it. It's not for selling, you know. Anyways, it's free. And you can see it in many different ways, so you don't really need to buy it unless you really, really, really want to. But it's there, this is the GitHub page. Everything is in GitHub, so that you can fork it. You can fork my novel. You don't like it? Just fork it. Right? You can create different characters. You can write a different thing. You can write a play. You can write a screenplay, whatever. Okay? And it's there. But the thing is, you're publishing everything as soon as you do it. Words and all. This guy, who knows this guy? Not you. Well, maybe you. I have another very nice black pencil, because writers were black, you see. So, who's this guy?
Neil Gaiman.
Sandman, excellent writer. He very recently published The Ocean at the End of the Lane. Excellent. Anything he writes. He's also wrote a book with Terry Pratchett, which is called Good Omens, which is hilarious. Very good writer. But he says, you don't have to say everything to the structure just to see if you made it right. Oh, but you do. Because CIPAM will not let you stop your novel if you don't test it. So, what do you need? This is... Okay. Writing is like software development. I said it. So everything is continuous integration. So this novel had from the very beginning, and the other novel I'm writing now, continuous integration, right? So do you know about continuous integration? Everybody knows how it works. Do I tell a little bit how it works? Continuous integration. The basic idea is that you test your code before incorporating it into some master branch or whatever, right? So, continuous integration, what does it do? When you do a patch, it's also a hook. So when you do a patch, it checks out your code, runs some tests, and then says it failed. Well, not really runs some tests. You can do some transformations, some stuff like compiling, things like that. And then it says it failed, and it fails here or there or whatever. Or it's okay, it's fixed. So what I did is I put continuous integration for my novel. And once again, I did it with Perl. So what I did is to create a model, a CIPAM module that integrated the novel and runs some tests on it. What kind of tests? Basically, typos, because there are two types of people in this world. Those who can edit and those who can't. So I didn't want to be the kind of people that did it. So I edited it. Of course, you can run it. I was writing with Cmax, of course. You can spell check. But you have this thing, do it for you, and edit with this program. So what I did is I put this as a test in a module which included the model. All the code is there, right? Basically what it does is it takes the text of the novel, which is right here, okay? It splits the text into different words, and then it spell checks the word. It's okay if the word is okay, right? So at the end, every time I do a poll, I get a report from Travis CI, something like this, saying, first, number of tests is 30,000. This is also the number of words you've written, which is very interesting because you know your progress. If you listen to writers on Twitter, they say all the time, I wrote 300 words today, I wrote 100 words. You can you can know exactly how many words you wrote today, because you have it here. Number of tests is number of words, right? So if you, if in the previous test you have, let's say, 20,000 words, in this test you have 30,000 words, you have 5,000 words more. You did quite a lot today. So you also know when you hit the mark of doing a novella, novelette, whatever. 30,000 is novelette, more or less. 35,000 would be something like a novel, short novel. 45,000 is more or less a novel. From 45,000 on, you have a big novel like Stephen King or Stieglason or whatever. But then there are more things. For Kincaid and Flesh, these are text quality measures. They are basically related to the number of different words you use and how the number of words increase when you increase the text. So if they have a low level, that means that you have a very poor vocabulary. You have high level, you have a good vocabulary, but you can have a, there is such a thing as having too high a level, because nobody will understand it, like the average, for instance. So and you must keep this between some level. And if there is a typo and this level goes too high or too low, continuous integration fails, I have to go back to work. And I did it, actually. I mean, it was like an incentive. I mean, it was something that was something to my laziness. You've written this, you fail, then you write, then you fix it, and then once you fix it, you write maybe 100 words more, or maybe just 3 words more. But you keep writing, and that's interesting, and that's cool. All the reports you see, there are something like 300 or I don't remember how many, but around 200. You can see it right there. You want to ask something? No? Any questions so far?
Actually, for the previous book that you said, well, okay. I don't want to say how many people bought it, but how many hits did you have on the people downloading it?
10.
Okay.
I mean, I did it very fast, and I also used a template, and I didn't take out all the stuff that was in the template before the book. So when people downloaded it and said, there's something here, learning it, and what's this? JJ is a very good writer, but he doesn't know Latin. Actually, I didn't know Latin. But anyways, I mean, they saw it as this is maybe December 28th, what was it? April Fool's, I mean, December Fool's, so, no, a joke. It's like that. But I really want to write it, so I have all the text there, and I want to rewrite it. So, about this thing, the continuous integration, I mean, I also say if it sucks or not. It's very interesting, because you know the quality, and you know whether what you have written a very particular day makes those indexes go up, indices go up or down, and that's interesting. I mean, you're assessing your book by yourself. You know what they say about editors? They are like a father figure for a writer. So I have as a father continuous integration. This is the book, right? You can buy it. Some people have done it, not very many. I think a dozen or so. But this is something that plays in your hubris, because when you publish something in Amazon, it publishes everywhere. And you become an author. Not a writer. Author. So it's right there. I mean, it's available in all the Amazon. It's a real book. It's a real story. It's a steampunk story. It's about, well, this is hand waving. It's a from hand waving. Just imagine that the Republic of Florida is independent and it's a socialist republic. And then there is a circus in that socialist republic, and there's a robot in that circus. And then the Americans send somebody to retrieve that, right? And it's about that. It's a story. It was originally called Hobart because it's a hobo story. It's some hobos gathering around the fire and talking about what they did, which might be true or not. So they talk and talk and talk, and they tell the story of this person going to get there. There are murderous clowns. There are racist people. There are not so racist people. There is a lot of. I mean, it's a short story. You can buy it. You can. You can buy it, but you can also have it here. Just go to CPANG, do CPANG text, :, hover, and you have it right there in your computer. Then you do Perl doc, text, hover, manual, and here's the novel. Right there in your computer, right? Why could I do this? Because it was written in Markdown. There is something which is called basically Markdown to pop, and then you have it. Okay, it's very easy to do. So, funny thing about doing things in the open source way is that you can compare them any way you want, anywhere you want. You can do it continuously, you can do it all the time. So Paul is very similar to Markdown. It's actually a little bit more complicated, so I didn't use it originally for Paul. Charles Strauss wrote a novel using Paul instead of using Beam. It's not so. That's more. I wrote another novel 4 or 5 years ago, and I wrote a module that's called Net, :, Lujo y Glamour, which is basically a URL shortener. And if you install it and you look in the test directory, the whole PDF of the novel is there. Yes, you can do it now if you want. Another thing is that Kindle, when you publish in Amazon, you publish something called Kindle Direct Publishing, and then it sends you reports of what you sold, what people don't want for free, whatever. It's an excellent report. So what I did was this module, which I didn't release in CBAM because it changes all the time, and they change the format of this Excel all the time. It's very useful for me because all my novels are open source. They're out there for everybody to see. So I want to be also transparent with what I sell, what I give for free, and so on and so forth. So everything is, all my sales are posted, and all my sales reports, I did do this. And then once it's in Markdown, you can do anything you want. You can put it in a path, like OpenShift, or in this case I did it with JavaScript, pardon me. I can do Perl Dancer, but I will do it later on. So, can Perl write your novel? No. Well, maybe, yes. But you can maximize your progress by doing it yourself. Help by Perl, and of course. And that's it. Thank you very much. If you have questions, I have pencils. Shoot. Yeah?
The manual de marketing management is such a good book. Would you recommend that?
It what?
Is it a good book? Would you recommend that?
I mean, I wrote it. It's not so bad. It's the first thing I wrote in English. So it's entertaining, it's funny, it's poignant, it's there, it's short. So whatever you do, you won't do it for long. Any other question? Okay, thank you very much.
You like the same writers, so you come to Amsterdam, let me know, come to our hackerspace.
Hey, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Pues yo un segundo. No quería, no tengo mucho tiempo, no puedo detenerme.